We're going to bring in NHL Network insider Elliotte Friedman for more on this. And let's start with Connor Hellebuyck. The deal is a good one. In terms of the Jets, what kind of value do they get out of a contract like this in the long term?
Well, first of all, I don't think Connor Hellebuyck's going to like that Michael Rock called him a big tool on NHL Network.
Nice.
It was an interesting choice of words, for sure.
Well, good point.
You know what? Like, he's a big piece of the puzzle. And I think that one of the reasons the Jets wanted to go for term, and we heard a while ago after their season ended that they wanted to not do a bridge deal with Hellebuyck. They wanted term. And I think the reason is that the Jets have a lot of financial decisions they have to make over the next little while. Hellebuyck was a big one. And I agree with you. I think they're going to be happy with that number for a long time. That's going to be, I think this is a contract that's going to do very well for Connor Hellebuyck and do very well for the Winnipeg Jets. But look, they've got to pay Patrick Laine. They've got to try and pay Jacob Trouba. They've got to pay Blake Wheeler, their best player last year. And that one may be a question of how much term the Jets want to go to. But there's no question they do want to extend them. And when you have to do all these things and you're an organization that's really going into the stratosphere of the salary cap for the first time, the most kind of knowledge you can have, cost certainty, is the best thing you can do. And that's why I understand why they did this. And I think it's a contract that over time, I think is going to come back to look very good both for Hellebuyck and the Jets.
Well, Elliotte, you know, when you look at some of these players in the league, and you can't obviously compare the rate going for each position, but when you want to get a top positional player for their position, respectively, you got goaltenders. Connor Hellebuyck's, you got to put him right up there. Obviously, this year was a big part of that and a big piece of that. And you look at some of the comparables this year, you got Vezina winner Pekka Rinne at $7 million. And we're showing this board right here. When you look positionally, you've got to pay a premium or be in that ballpark for some of these players. You want a centerman? Well, the best centerman out there, the guy who's setting the bar there, is Connor McDavid. And you can argue Sidney Crosby and Jonathan Toews are the next coming as far as their salary. But this is a goaltender that's one of the tops in the league and probably is for years to come. And he's coming in at undervalue. So, you know, maybe you could just talk about how difficult it is for teams, maybe even teams like Winnipeg, to go and get a guy like that and get him under contract long term.
Well, I think one of the things you have to recognize, Michael, is that a lot of those contracts, and not all of them, but some of them bought unrestricted free agent years. And some of Hellebuyck's did, but the fact is, some of them also bought restricted years. Like the top paid goaltender is Carey Price. He's at $10.5 million. Henrik Lundqvist is at a very big number. But if you take a look at that, and there you have it there at $8.5 million, all of Price's years and all of Lundqvist's years were unrestricted free agent years. Bobrovsky is going to be in that area when he signs his next deal. He's got one more year, and then they're all unrestricted free agent years. Hellebuyck didn't have that. Some of his are restricted years. And also, as you guys mentioned off the top, he's coming off his first great season and the first time he's going into a year as the unquestioned, unqualified number one goaltender on a team. So that's why the number is a little bit lower. And I think here the Jets, you know, Hellebuyck's looking at this deal and saying, look, if he takes a bridge and he signs for 2 years and he does what he did last year, he's going up closer to 10. But he takes more money now because he decides to lock in and give the Jets some help and also make himself a very wealthy man. It's not really a It's not really a loser in this situation. It's a win-win for both sides.
And based on what Connor said, too, he really does believe that the Jets are contenders to win a Stanley Cup one day, and now he's got 6 years and $37 million attached to his name. But the Jets not the only team doing business today. A trade between the Hawks and the Coyotes. Take us through that deal and sort of what it means for each of those teams.
Well, here's the situation. The Chicago Blackhawks last year, when Marian Hossa retired, there was talk, would they ever try to move the contract? And they didn't last year, but they did talk about it this year. And Marian Hossa still has 3 more years on his contract. The actual cap is 5.7, but the actual salary drops down to about $1 million. And because Hossa won't play, 80% of that is covered by insurance. So the Coyotes are going to only have to pay $200,000 of it. I think the Chicago Blackhawks wanted to remove that so they have more flexibility to do some things. Yes, you can put them on long-term injury, but there are complications with that. You can't do it to the second day of the season. If you're not right at the cap, there are problems. And then if you have other injury situations, there can become even more problems. I think they wanted to increase their flexibility. They talked about this with Carolina. I do believe, guys, at one point this offseason, there was talk of a trade of Hossa's money going to, or a situation going to Carolina for Scott Darling. That didn't happen, so they went to Arizona. The key they had to give up there is they had to give up Vinny Hinostroza. There was a player that I think is really coming. There was a player that Arizona valued, and they said that, look, if you want us to do this, you have to give us this young, talented player who we think could really help us. I think the big question now is, what does Chicago do with the cap room? They've been linked to Justin Falk. Is that a move they make? Is it possible they see if they can enter the Erik Karlsson situation? I don't know if they have what Ottawa would want to do that. Or I also wonder if the possibility they go after a scorer like Max Pacioretty. But one thing they do have now is they have room to maneuver that they didn't have before, because Hossa's cap hit is no longer on their books.
Elliot, you just mentioned Max Pacioretty. Any updates on that front up in Montreal?
No, you know what, Michael? It's been quiet. I always am afraid to say that the moment we hang up, and I'm going to look like a big doofus. But, you know, I think it's been quiet. You know, you saw the report the other day from Marc-Antoine Gaudin from The Athletic that the Canadians have told him they won't extend him and they are going to trade him. Look, Max Pacioretty at the draft, there was a trade on the table with the Kings. And I heard the extension was somewhere in the neighborhood of 5 years and a little bit over $6 million. And I think the issue for Pacioretty was, one, he had to make a decision quick and he didn't like that. And two, he wanted to see if he could get more on the market. And I think it was just a lot of frustration that boiled over, Mike. But we're in a situation now where teams are kind of saying, okay, what does Pacioretty want? And B, I think Pacioretty wants to have a better idea of what's out there. So he switched agents. We're kind of seeing where we are, but the Canadians have said they're going to trade him. It's just hard to trade a guy when you want, when you're not sure what he wants to sign for, or you don't like that number.
And how about Erik Karlsson? It wasn't that long ago that people thought that there was some sort of trade in place with the Tampa Bay Lightning. That didn't end up happening. What's the latest on Erik Karlsson and his future?
Well, I think, Jackie, first of all, I don't think that Tampa trade was close. So I think, you know how things go. They spread like wildfire.
Yes.
I don't think we ever got to that point. You know, Steve Yzerman, they signed Kucherov to a contract the other day. He was asked about adding pieces. He said we could, but we have to switch things around. I think that Tampa knows if they are going to have to make a deal, they will have interested teams willing to take players if they offer a sweetener. My biggest question about Tampa is, they made a futures deal to get Ryan McDonagh. If they were to get Erik Karlsson, they'd have to make a futures deal for him, and they'd probably also have to make a futures deal to trade a player off their roster. As good as they are about drafting and developing, that's a lot of futures deals to make. I think that would even be difficult for them to pull off. I still think Dallas is very much there. I still think Ottawa is trying to create more of a market. But, you know, I think if Bobby Ryan is still going to be part of this deal, to me that screams Vegas is the team with the best option to do it if they want to. But if it's just Karlsson, I still think Dallas is a very serious contender. I'm just not hearing anything right now, and Karlsson is overseas in Scotland on a golf trip as we're doing this.
Okay. He knows everything, Elliot. He knows everything.
Jackie, I'm not that smart. He's put it out on social media. That's how we know.
Well, it's going to be weird to see Erik Karlsson in any jersey that's not an Ottawa Senators jersey, but it sounds like that will be happening sooner rather than later. Elliot, I love the summer beard that you're rocking. You look great, and thanks for taking time during your summer to talk to us.
My pleasure, guys. Have a great week.
You too.